Hi, my name is John Doyle, and I have the privilege of being the artistic director at Classic Stage. At Classic Stage, for a couple of years now, we've done a series of events called Classic Conversations, and they're really quite in-depth conversations between myself and an artist. And they follow the form of a BBC program, much loved program in the United Kingdom, called Desert Island Discs. And what the artist does is chooses a series of songs or pieces of music that are meaningful to them that they would take to their desert island. And the conversation follows the shape of the songs. The live versions of these are much longer, but we're doing, this is the first of a series of half-hour conversations with a couple of songs within. And I'm very pleased that our first castaway to the desert island is Brandon Uranowitz.
Hi, John.
Hi, Brandon. How are you doing?
I'm okay. I'm hanging in on our
virtual desert island that this program is following. I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? Because it feels like a time to contemplate as well. You know, we've got to look at the positive side of it. The why has this happened to us? There's good in it too.
I think so. I mean, the good about it is that we've now been forced to reflect on things and reflect on, I guess, habits that we've gotten into as a culture, as a society, as people.
That's right.
I think that reflection on the other side will bear good fruit. I hope.
My goodness, we're going to have an awful lot to bring back to our rehearsal rooms. That's for sure.
Oh, yeah,
it
feels so, I don't know, appropriate for our show. Just thinking about what our world is going through right now and what different sects of people are going through.
So, in talking about reflecting, this business that we call it, that you're in, this industry, I'm not sure about that word, but you know, this activity that we share together, how did it begin for you? Where's the beginning of it? Was it at home?
I grew up the very, very beginning of it.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds cliche and kind of saccharine, but the very beginning of it was, I'm at my parents' house in New Jersey right now, but I grew up in New Jersey right outside of New York City. So when I showed early signs of being terrible at sports as a kid, my parents took me to a Broadway show. It was Peter Pan, and I was riveted. And my mom said that, you know, when I she watched me more than she watched the show, because I was so entranced by the magic of the whole experience. It wasn't even just what was going on stage for me. It was the entire ceremony of it all. Of walking into the theater and getting your playbill and having the lights up and the commotion of the audience, and then the lights go down. And then obviously it was very magical for a kid because there were people flying, but it was wonderful. That was it for me. And then they put me into theater school at a very early age, and I was an introverted, shy kid, but for some reason, when I could pull it together, I felt free and myself on stage. And like,
Do you still feel like the introverted, shy kid who is free on stage? I think that's a very common thing for a lot of artists, isn't it? That, you know, the sense of not being able to being able to express oneself, but doing it better through another person is
exactly
fascinating.
Yeah, right. Just to embody other ways of thinking, ways of being. I don't know. In a weird, strange way, gets you closer to yourself. I don't know. I guess it's about finding those versions of yourself.
I think that's exactly right. And so you were in the, correct me if I'm wrong about this, but you were in the original Ragtime?
It was sort of a strange series of circumstances. I was doing Evita at Paper Mill Playhouse in New Jersey as a kid, and this audition came up. I had started working with an agent with my parents and I, and this audition came in, and I ultimately didn't get it. It went to Paul Dano, who's a big movie star now.
Yeah.
He booked the role for the premiere in Toronto, but they don't really do this anymore. But a strange thing that they did, I think it was Live Ent and Garth Drabinsky at the time, they did two productions at the same time. They opened in Toronto, then opened another production in Los Angeles. And so I flew out. They asked me to come back and audition again in LA. And at that point, apparently, Paul was leaving the show. I don't know what the circumstances of that were, but he was leaving the show. And I ended up replacing him like 2 or 3 months into their run, and then finished out the run up there. And then I didn't come to Broadway for a number of reasons.
Yeah.
I did the world premiere of it with Audra and Stokes and
incredible
Dear Maren and
Maren and Grazie Danielle doing the choreography and Terrence.
Yep.
Now that we've lost him, but extraordinary, really.
It was.
You know, you then, I mean, having played as a kid, if you like, you then went to NYU. I mean, you decided you wanted to look at it properly, if that makes sense.
But I came back and it was just. I guess the theme of this is loneliness and isolation, but I felt, again, I sort of felt like as a kid, I was living on an island. I was missing school all the time. I didn't have a ton of close friends. And I just felt isolated and alone. And so I decided I sort of wanted to stop working professionally as a kid, go to school, go to college. I knew I would always come back to theater, but an interesting thing that happened to me in high school, it was a different time, and I was very determined. I mean, if we're going to get really into it, I was very determined when I was in high school to, I guess, stay in the closet. I wasn't really out to my family or anybody, and part of my strategy there for some crazy reason was to not do musicals. And so I didn't do the musicals, and I only did
people do the musicals. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Just such a narrow point of view, which is expanding now, I think.
Yeah. Yeah.
Luckily. But I decided to just do the plays, and I really fell in love, and there was an English class in high school that I was taking called Modern Drama, and I was introduced to Sam Shepard and, you know, Eugene O'Neill and Arthur Miller and all of these incredible, Tennessee Williams, all of the greats.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I fell in love with it, and I decided I wanted to be an actor. I wanted to go to NYU for drama, and I didn't go for musical theater, and I just sort of found my way back to it.
Yeah. It's always interested me, particularly in America, how it is almost like, I mean, I was struck when I first went to the Tonys, and the theater people, the play people sit on one side of the auditorium and the musical theater people sit on the other. And I thought, wow, you know, to me, like in Britain, our top musical theater star is Judi Dench. And I think, for some, you know, like, it's a completely different way of looking at it. I think that is changing, though. I mean, I really do think that.
I think so. It was a theme of a lot of interviews I did last year during Tony season when I was doing Burn This. Because there is this weird opinion notion in American theater that the straight drama and musical theater are two separate schools and they have to be separate, but it's all the same to me. I mean, maybe I like to think of it as just you're using two different doors to get into the exact same room.
Absolutely. It is funny though, is that they talk about legit theater, and you know, it makes me think, oh, so is musical theater illegitimate?
It's illegitimate theater.
Yeah. So listen, you have 3 Tony nominations. That's not bad for a young guy, really. Pretty good. And so tell me and 2 of those for musicals. So tell me the title of your first of your 2 songs that you're going to bring to your desert island.
Well, the first is from a show from that I got my second nomination for from Falsettos. It's not a song that I sang, but it's a song that means a lot to me because it's from that show that means so much to me. And it's also about a gay relationship. It's What More Can I Say from Falsettos by the great William Finn. And that show was just sort of a watershed moment for me in finding my voice as an actor, finding my footing in the Broadway community. It was just a turning point for me as an actor. And this song is so beautiful and doesn't shy away from its sort of saccharine cheesiness, because when we are in love and when we are having those feelings, they are that way. And we can't help but express ourselves in that way. And I just love it. And I love singing it. And I love the journey that it takes.
So we're going to get that treat right now.
Oh, thanks.
It's been hot, also very sweet, and I'm not usually indiscreet. But when he sparkles, the earth begins to sway. What more can I say? How can I express? How confused am I by our happiness? I can't eat breakfast. I cannot tie my shoes. What more can I do? If I say I love him, you might think my words come cheap. Let's just say I'm glad he's mine, awake, asleep. It's been hot. Also, it's been swell. More than not, it's been more than words can tell. I halt, I stammer, I sing a rondelay. What more can I say? I'll stay. I was taught never brag or shout. Still it's hot, just like how you read about. And also caring and never too uncouth. That's the simple truth.
That was beautiful. Thank you. So listen, I want just to tell everybody that, if you're enjoying what we're talking, how we're talking, or enjoyed that song, I'm sure, then please like our page on Facebook or subscribe to our channel on YouTube and share this video with your friends and your family. It would mean a lot to us at Classic Stage. I'm almost embarrassed to say that we're also accepting donations on our website at the theatre just to keep us going through this difficult time. So if you want to click on classicstage.org/cc, you can support us there.
And please do.
We need all the support we can get, don't we, Brandon? It was so strange, wasn't it, leaving our rehearsal room and suddenly discovering that we weren't going back in.
Oh my, it was, I can't, I have a hard time describing it because I don't know, it was sort of devastating. Okay. When you build up momentum like that and just come to such a sudden halt.
I know. It's the strangest feeling, isn't it? It's only happened to me once before in my career. Many, many, many years ago, there were big employment strikes going on in the UK and they stopped, various productions had to stop, and it happened to me then. And that was a different situation. This one I know will happen again, so I feel okay about it in the end. But yeah. It's like suddenly you are like, what do I do with all that information? Where is it going to go, all that emotional information as well that we learn in the course of what we do in the rehearsal room? And I think particularly when you're making a musical of the work of people like Steve and John, I mean, you know, Steve Sondheim and John Wideman, it's even more so. And we have a piece, though, in common that I've always wanted to talk to you about, never really had the chance in the rehearsal room.
I would love to.
Yeah, and that's Roadshow. Which you did at Encores, and which I did with them originally at the Public and at the Chocolate Factory in London. How was it? Did you enjoy it? I mean, you have such a short time to do those Encores shows.
It was without question the most challenging thing I've ever done in my career. Yeah. And because of that, was probably the most satisfying. Because we had to put up a Sondheim-Wideman show up in 6 or 7 days, I think it was. It wasn't even Encores, it was like Encores off-center.
Oh, so that's right, it was that the summer one, yeah. Yeah.
And so it was, but our director, Will, was so prepared and so open to ideas and making discoveries. And what I also love about the Encores setup is that you don't have time to overthink anything.
That's
you
right.
just sort of make a choice and go with it.
That's right.
And the beautiful thing about Wideman and Sondheim is they do pretty much all the work for you.
Yeah.
Learning it and getting it in your body is one thing, but the work of connecting dots and finding arcs and finding motivation and backstory, it's all there for you.
All of it, yeah.
Yeah, and it was thrilling. It was completely thrilling. I love that show.
So do I.
So much. It is such a weird, incongruous, like bizarre, beautiful show.
Yeah. Have you been, I think we shared this a little in the rehearsal room, but can you feel and hear the connections between it and Assassins?
So much.
So much.
So very much. What I love about John and Steve so much is that they love to explore love and relationships that are not often explored and that are not often seen as love relationships.
Yeah.
And those are really, really fun to play because they exist in the real world, but we don't often view them as love stories. You know, like we've got the two brothers in Roadshow and that love story, which, I mean, Roadshow, I think, ends with the greatest love song of all time. In Assassins, we've got, I mean, for me, it's, you know, Chulgosh and Emma Goldman. I mean, it's
yeah.
Beautiful, brilliant, unexplored dynamics that I wouldn't want anyone else to really give voice to other than those two.
I know. I mean, Roadshow, when we did it originally, was such a remarkable experience because, as you know, the piece had gone through various other great people's hands. So it felt like this incredible responsibility. And yet, they made it so freeing, you know, the sense of, look, it hasn't been working. Please just go there, go for it. Mm-hmm. And it was truly joyous to do it. Certainly one of, if not the most satisfying experience of my career, most certainly. I loved working at the Public anyway. I love working at the Chocolate Factory. They have the same kind of earthy energy that classic stage has in right. my mind. But, you know.
And I would say the same thing about Annie Kaufman at City Center.
Yeah, absolutely. Someday we must get you to come to Classic Stage to do a classic role. You've played Richard III, did I read somewhere?
Well, yeah, that was the other thing is, you know, going back to when I fell in love with plays and playwrights. And then when I was at NYU, after I did Meisner for 2 years, I went and I did classical with Louis Schieder at NYU for a year. And I did only Shakespeare for a year of my life. And I fell so in love with it. Wonderful. I really thought that I would have a career in, when I did classical, I left, I was like, I'm just going to do Shakespeare. That's all I ever want to do. And I haven't really been able to do it professionally. I would love to.
I'm sure you'll get to.
My favorite. You know,
it's very hard though. It's hard to get to do it consistently. I think that's the challenge with Shakespeare. You maybe get to do one. I mean, when we did the Scottish play earlier on in the season that I won't mention the title on here, but, earlier on in the season at Classic Stage, and you know, some of the actors were saying, wow, this is the first time I've been paid to speak Shakespeare.
Right.
But when I grew up in the United Kingdom, you know, companies like the Royal Shakespeare Company, actors went there for 2 years at a time and did nothing but Shakespeare plays every night of their lives. I mean, you can just imagine.
A dream to me.
It's just extraordinary dream. Because, of course, there's an enormous connection between that language and the language we're talking about with Steve Sondheim and John Wyman. I mean, it's not for nothing that people call Sondheim the Shakespeare, the American Shakespeare. There's no, you know, the use of word, the rhythm, it's all connected up in my mind.
It's the rhythm, it's the heightened language, it's the heightened circumstances that also feel utterly human and real, even though they exist on sort of another plane.
That's right.
It's the meatiest, juiciest, you know, thing you could sink your teeth into as an actor. Is Shakespeare.
Haven't we got go back to Assassins? Haven't we got an extraordinary company?
I think it was John on the first. It was John Wideman on the first day of rehearsal who looked around the room, and I think he said what we were all feeling. It was just breathtaking looking around the room. When I walked in on the first day and I saw all of those people sit, you, John, Judy, Steve, Will, all of these people. It's breathtaking.
Yeah, I know. It's exciting.
And again, it made it that much more devastating.
I know.
But it really, it's a dream. It's a dream, and I'm so grateful for it. And I can't wait to get back to it. That company is just,
me too.
It's perfect. It doesn't really get better than that.
So your second song for your desert island, is by Stephen Sondheim. Yes.
Yes.
From a show that didn't work. When it was originally done. I was fortunate enough to do the British premiere of it. I think we kind of made it work, I don't know. But it was a wonderful score. Tell us what it is and why.
Well, it's With So Little to Be Sure Of from Anyone Can Whistle, which, as you said, is a show that is troubled, I think. But the score is stunning. And this song is one of the first Sondheim songs I ever sang sort of as a kid.
Yeah.
And I chose it for this because the lyrics just feel, I mean, honestly, the lyrics feel even too on the nose.
Yeah.
I think for what we're going through right now. And it feels like, again, going back to cheesy, corny, saccharine stuff, it feels like my relationship with theater at the, yeah. during this time.
Yeah.
I knew when we started quarantining that it was the right thing to do, and I went into it knowing what we had to do, and I sort of ignored the fact that I was not going to be doing theater. And as we've had all of this time to reflect, I'm realizing, particularly this past couple of weeks, how much I miss theater and doing theater and seeing theater and creating theater. But I also know that it is the one constant, and we will recover and we will come back.
For sure.
And I am sure of it. And I am sure of my relationship with it. So that's sort of why I chose it.
And the lyric says in the song, with so little to be sure of.
Yeah.
And we have a moment. I love that lyric. We have a moment, a marvelous moment, a beautiful time, which is also very beautiful.
Yeah.
Let's listen to it.
With so little to be sure of, if there's anything at all, if there's anything at all, I'm sure of here and now and us together. All I'll ever be, I owe you. If there's anything to be, being sure enough of you makes me sure enough of me. Thanks for everything we did, everything that's past, everything that's over too fast. None of it was wasted, all of it will last. Everything that's here and now and us together, it was marvelous to know you. And it isn't really through crazy business this life we live in.
So Brandon, usually when they do Desert Island Discs in the UK, it finishes with a few questions.
Okay.
Coming from me. And the first of them is, if you're only allowed one luxury to bring to your desert island, what would it be?
One luxury. A luxury, I mean, I want to say it would be all of the photos from my life.
Okay.
I don't know if that's a luxury, though.
I think that is a luxury to look at your... I certainly think that's a luxury.
I mean, part of me thinks that would compound the devastation of being alone and isolated. Yeah. But yeah. I think also, I imagine that fantasy and reflection as we... are feeling. I mean, I've even found myself in isolation and in quarantine going through old photos just
to
remember what it was like.
Yes. And also how, I'm sure you found the same as I'm finding, but how many people one wants to reach out to. You know, I tend not to do very much social media, but I find myself writing to a lot of people that I've wanted to reconnect
with. I'm typically very... And I apologize to anybody watching who is I am friendly with. I'm typically very bad at using this.
Yeah.
I'm not great But it has sort of been a lifeline. And okay. I've been reaching out to so many people and reconnecting with so many people.
Yes. And you know, for all I've often cursed technology in so many ways, could you imagine this period of time if we hadn't had these connections?
No.
Extraordinary.
I truly cannot picture it. I cannot imagine it. I don't know what that would be.
Extraordinary. So that's your luxury, your book or your box of photographs. If you're allowed to bring to your desert island two books, one, a religious book, it could be the Bible or whatever else is your faith or what you're religiously interested in, and you're allowed to bring the complete works of Shakespeare. Okay. So that's good. But you're also allowed one more book. What would it be?
Oh, God. Okay, so I'm allowed the complete works of Shakespeare and another book. I'm just going through in my head. The first thing you said, this is going to sound so pretentious, but I want to say The Empty Space.
Yeah.
By Peter Brook. I just, it to me is everything I want theater to be. And I think I would want to remember theater using that language.
Yes.
And that imagery.
Yeah. Yes. As I shared with you, I think probably on the first day, he's my hero. So, that way of thinking about theater, I completely...
Yeah, now I'm thinking about it, if I have the complete works of Shakespeare, maybe I don't need another book to remind me of the theater I no longer have.
Don't worry about it. You can
say that.
That'll do. And the other cast members who are going to have these conversations with me, they're lucky because they're going to be rehearsing what they want to bring.
Of course.
So you were the first. Exactly. And if you were only allowed one of those two songs, which would it be?
Oh. That's so mean. I think With So Little to Be Sure Of. I
understand that. And finally, I get that. And finally, you're allowed to ask me one question. What would you like to ask me?
John, Sir John Doyle, what was the show? The one show that you did that you are most proud of?
Well, I think it would be a production that I did of The Three Sisters,
mm-hmm.
which was an adaptation by Sarah Rule.
Oh.
And I did it down at Cincinnati Playhouse in the Park. And I don't think the audience knew what the hell was going on in front of them, but it was one of the most truly precious times. And it was, the cast had Corey Stoll, Frank Wood, Lila Robbins, so many people. I mean, it just goes on and on and on and on, the number of people that were in it. Dear Lynn Cohen, who died recently. It was a very, Alma Cuervo, who played the original mother in when I did Roadshow. And it was just the opportunity to go somewhere with great actors, which I've been very blessed to do so many times, and work on great words, which I think is what I'm most interested in, really. Yeah. And an extraordinary story. I think that would probably be my desert island production. Not to say that I didn't love doing Sweeney Todd and I had towards doing Company and all those other things. It's not a reflection on any of that. But that was just something about a special meeting of minds at a time that felt important to me. So that would be mine.
I understand that.
It's been lovely to talk to you.
You too, John. I can't wait to
I can't wait to
be in the same room with you.
See you properly again soon.
And I can't wait to share the show.
Yeah, me too.
It really is going to be special.
And it'll be more meaningful now than it ever was. I think so.
So
I'll remind everybody that we are accepting donations for our... We have the pleasure of doing the talking. It would be lovely if you could help the theatre at Classic Stage. So the website is classicstage.org/cc. You can find our... If you like, you can like our page on Facebook, subscribe to our channel on YouTube, and share this video with your friends of me talking to my friend. And if you'd like to join us every Thursday, that would be great. Next Thursday is 6 o'clock for the premiere of each Classic Conversation event at Facebook or YouTube. And next week, I'll be joined by Will Swenson. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks, bye, John. Friend. Bye.
Bye-bye.